For your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire, and in darkest night you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. Hey! 'Cause all my life you have been faithful.
Oh, yes, you have.
And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your
pray. Most merciful God, loving Father, who art in heaven, to whom all flesh must come, we come into your presence, where our souls find delight. For in your presence there is fullness of joy. And it is this joy that gives us strength. And so, God, we look to you tonight, from whence cometh our help, knowing that our help cometh from you, which have made heaven and earth. We in ourselves, we cannot help ourselves, but in you we move and we have our very beings. And so, God, we pray tonight that you would draw close to us. Even this family, Lord God, we pray that you would draw close to them, because you are a God who cares, who is touched by the feeling of our infirmities. And when we hurt, you are mindful to care for us. I pray, God, this night that you would draw close to us. You have always been close to those that are broken heart and those that have a crushed spirit. And so we pray, God, tonight that you would just comfort those who mourn. And as we mourn with them, God, we pray that you would be the one, Lord, who would lift us out of despair. For we know, God, that you are a God who brings hope. And so tonight we look to you. We commit this service to you. We pray that you would bless everything that would be said and done. And at the conclusion, Lord, may your name get the honor and the glory. In Jesus' name. And the people say, amen. Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Allman Beaver. Let me introduce myself, Reverend Oswald Jones. We are co-pastors here at Community Worship Center. And to all of you who are guests of the family, who are here to remember your history and your thoughts with the deceased, we praise God and we ask his touch on your heart. But remember, anytime you enter here, you are family. You're not just a guest, you're family. So seeing that, you may be seated. You want to?
Hello. You're going to do some more singing?
As the singing goes on, listen, you are at home. If you wish to stand, clap, whatever the Spirit leads you to do, we are not here on our own. We are here with the Holy Spirit. So may he bless you in goodness. Amen.
You can join me in song. Like the pastor said, we're in Amazing Grace. We all know this song. It's a hymn number 85. You can stand, you can sing with me if you'd like. Amen.
Testament lesson, Psalm 23, the Psalm of David, of assurances that God is with us at all times. And it reads, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Amen.
It's God. Hymn number 442, Blessed Assurance. First verse, blessed assurance, Jesus is mine.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, worship of God. Lord,
of the Word of God. This is coming from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 51 through 58. Listen, you NIV, I'm coming from NIV. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a flash, in the twinkling of an eye at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that will be written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Cause all my life you have been faithful.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. I'm going to try my best to get through this because I said I had to do it. So as I'm standing here with my son and the Council General for support, I'm going to try my best to get through this without breaking down. Ivan Nichols, beloved known as Nick and Terry, entered this world on August 21st, 1936 in Ellerton, St. George, Barbados, where he was the eldest of 10 children born to late Edward Price and Ethelene Pitt. He had 6 brothers and 3 sisters. He received his formal education at St. Luke's Boys School. During his youth, he helped out at his father's grocery shop. Subsequently worked at the Buckley Sugar Factory in Barbados before he ventured off to England in 1961. It was in England where he met and married Eureka Grant, my mom. They had 2 children, son and daughter, which is me. I'm his daughter, Caroline Nichols and Wayne Nichols. Ivan dedicated 15 years of service at the United States Air Base, Ivan, as his family eventually moved and settled in Brooklyn, New York in 1976. After establishing his residence here in New York City, Ivan broke barriers by opening Nick's Barbados Bakery and Restaurant. He was the first Bajan ever to open up a bakery in New York. This establishment was widely successful, where people from all over the world would drive and fly in just to get a taste of his bread and food. Ivan also founded many clubs, most notably the Remsen Cave. This led to him establishing himself in the nightlife industry. Ivan set an exemplar blueprint for others to be able to build successful businesses. Ivan was not only a great businessman, but also a strong, gifted man. He was an amazing son, a father, grandfather, great-grandfather, sibling, uncle, nephew, partner, and friend. He loved to live life to the fullest and brought him joy to bring others together. He was the life of the party. On his free time, he loved to play records and listen to music, watch wrestling, cook, bake, train dogs, and play cards with his friends. Ivan Nichols was the epitome of a free spirit. His strength and resilience will forever be in our hearts. He leaves behind many loved ones and will truly, truly be missed. It takes a minute to find a special person, an hour to appreciate them, a day to love them, but it takes an entire life to forget them. I miss you, Dad. I love you. You're always gonna be in my heart. I don't even know what to say right now. I'm so choked up, but I thank everyone for coming out. I appreciate everyone here. I wanna give a special shout out to those people. Tiffany, I thank you for your help. Ming, thank you for everything. Damien, thank you for being here. Jennifer, thank you for washing and bathing and doing everything you had to do. Thank you, Herschel. I'm leaving you for last. Thank you, Ricky, Sean, Sierra. Thank you for your calls. Marva, thank you so much for being there with my dad as he went along. Who else I'm forgetting? I don't want to, Saina, I'm tired of you calling me 55 times in a day trying to find it. Oswald, thank you so much. It was a great help. Auntie Edith, thank you so much. I don't know. Shelly, thank you for coming to help, you know, do what you do. Kareem, you're the greatest. I love you. Now, I got to save the 2 best for last. My mother, I love you so much. Although we have ups and downs and everything, I love you. I love you. You're the greatest. You're the best mother. And I want the world to know you are the best. Herschel, let me tell you something. Please come up here. Come up here. Please. You have to come up here. You got to thank Herschel. Thank you for everything that you've done. Sean, did I shout you out with your big head cell? All right, good. Everybody else, thanks for all your calls. Herschel, come up here, please. Let me tell this so the world could know this was going on up in here. Thank you so much. I want to thank you. A lot of things, Herschel, that I couldn't do without you. You are the greatest man. I love you. I appreciate you, although we bump heads sometimes, whatever it is, I love you. Had not for everything, it wouldn't happen right now. You would give anybody their last. I appreciate it. It's not about her, it's about my dad, but I have to shout everyone out. I appreciate everyone. Whoever I didn't call, I thank you. I'm sorry. Where's Sabrina? Sabrina here? All right, she's not here. I thank everybody for the calls. I feel so good. I'm happy. I thought I was going to break down, but I'm not. Tiffany, respect. Love everybody so much, and thank everybody for coming out.
Honorable Lorenzo Hero, Barbados State Comptroller General at New York, and members of the bereaved family, brothers and sisters in Christ, I take this opportunity to extend condolences to the other members of the family, and rest be assured that the good Lord will build a hedge of protection around you at this time. Nick, I'm sure there's no question that he was a trailblazer. He said it for, you know, adverts came after him, but in the late 70s, early 80s, everything centered around Nick's bakery and restaurant. He was, as stated, he was a family man, and he made a great contribution to the Barbadian community. I'm sure that his service would make his family very proud, and it's something that all Barbadians, you know, should embrace. So in closing, I thank you very much for being with the family at this time, and I'm sure that you will keep us in our prayers. We are down in the valley at this time, but we will move to the mountaintop where there is joy and praise. So thank you very much.
Am I mistaken, or did I hear there's another Oswald here? There is? Where are you? My twin brother. We've come to the point where we are going to have tributes to Brother Nichols. Beginning, we understand that the Council General for Barbados is here with us. Will you please come? You will begin the tributes to this wonderful man that we know. Thank you. Let's give him a hand, yeah.
Good afternoon, everyone. Former Consul General, Mr. Lennox Price. Ladies and gentlemen, today we gather to honor the memory of a remarkable individual. Let me look away from the script first and acknowledge that I'm extremely disappointed for having been within this space for the last few months and not being given the opportunity to meet the gentleman and have a few words, because he clearly represents one of the key focuses of my particular mandate here, which is focusing on strengthening Barbadians, not only in terms of the cultural projection of the country, but also the economic value that we can offer at the community level and projecting business continuity as well. But I'll get back to the script now, because other persons have tributes to make, and I really am feeling overwhelmed to not have had the opportunity to meet this wonderful gentleman and everything that he represents. And just to lighten the mood, I hope that no one is offended if by the time I pass here, there are three salt breads instead of four salt breads. But today we gather to honor the memory of a remarkable individual, Mr. Nichols, a man whose life and work have left an indelible mark on both his family and communities in which he resided and operated. As Consul General of Barbados at New York, it is my privilege to highlight a person who exemplified the very best of our Barbadian spirit and our resilience. Mr. Nichols was not just a successful businessman. He was a beacon of perseverance and dedication. His bakery, a beloved institution in New York, and his community, it was built on the principles of hard work, integrity, and a passion for quality. These are the very values that we and you, some of you, as Barbadians hold very dear. Through his business, Mr. Nichols provided more than just baked goods, as you can see there. He offered a piece of home to many in the diaspora, creating a sense of community and a sense of belonging amongst Barbadians. His journey from Barbados to New York and his subsequent achievements is testament to the importance of business continuity across our diaspora. I believe Mr. Nichols understood that a thriving business is not merely about profitability and revenue and loss, but it was also about contributing to a broader community, creating jobs, sustaining livelihoods, maintaining families, as his lovely family is here today, and also fostering economic growth. His legacy is a powerful reminder to me, and it ought to be to you as well, that our contributions as Barbadians extend far beyond our own borders, and that the benefits sometimes accrue to other generations. This is what we call sacrificing today for the betterment of tomorrow, even if tomorrow we're not here to enjoy the fruits of our labor today. The success of our diaspora is vital to the development of Barbados, but supporting each other and ensuring the continuity of our practices as we strengthen our collective impact is equally as beneficial. Mr. Nichols Bakery is a shining example of this. It served as a bridge between our culture and the world, showcasing the talents and flavors of our beloved island. As we reflect today on Mr. Nichols' life, let us draw inspiration from his example. Let us remember that every business, large or small, every entrepreneurial endeavor contributes to the tapestry of our very Barbadian community. It is through such efforts that we can preserve our heritage, support our economy, and inspire future generations to pursue their dreams with the same tenacity and dedication that Mr. Nichols displayed. To his lovely family, on behalf of the Consulate General of Barbados, I extend my deepest condolences. We hope you find comfort in knowing that Mr. Nichols' legacy will live on through the countless lives he touched and the community he helped to build. His spirit of excellence, community service, and cultural pride will continue to inspire us all. Thank you.
We have a selection now coming from Mr. Nichols. Hellman.
I'm sorry, everyone, but my brother Wayne unfortunately couldn't make it with us here today. But I thank you, Wayne. I know you're looking live stream. I thank you for knowing everything and being there all the time with me on FaceTime, every step of the way with your father. Every time we were in the hospital together, thank you for talking to the doctors. Thank you for talking to the nurses. Thank you for your support. Thank you for everything, Wayne. I love you.
If you give a little more than you take, and if you try to fix more than you break, if you're the kind who take the time to help a stranger on the way, there's a place for people like you. If you stand up for those down on their knees and lend a voice to those who cannot speak, if you stand for those, your days down here are through. There's a place up there for people like you. If you walk around with your heart on your sleeve, people like you, I know I've heard up there the streets are made of gold, and when there's only you, for people like you, if you shine a little light and give sight to the one who lost their way, there's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold, but there are people like you. Oh, 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 oh. I'm sorry, folks.
You are an amazing daughter. You sit up here and you thank everyone, but I just want to say I have two daughters, and if they're just half as good to me as you were to your dad, I'm just a lucky woman. I just want to say you drove me nuts. You called me out in the middle of the night, but when you said we got to go, we got to go. You know, you did so much. I said, get out of your dad's mouth. Leave him alone. The hospital staff called me. Come get Carol. Carol, what are you still doing there? You were an amazing daughter. You did the best for your dad, okay? But please, I would never let you be my healthcare proxy, power of attorney, okay? But you are everything. You gave your dad the peace he needed when he, the last end, and you knew it was, his journey was over. And God bless you, continue to bless you. What you did for your dad is going to go from generations, from your grand to your son to your granddaughter. Just know that God is with you, and your dad is always in your heart. Okay? All right.
Okay, we have come to the point where we are going to have you, the audience, if you care to say a few words about our brother. I'm trying to figure out how you're going to get to the mic. I'd like you to line up on this side to see, just so we can see how many of you are going to be coming up, because it's a two-minute talk. So all of you who will be given a two-minute condolences to our brother, just line up in the center aisle. I only see one person. Okay. Turn the mic.
Good evening, church. First, let me express to the Nicholas family my deepest sympathy and condolences. But I didn't come here to pay a tribute to Nick. Because you can't pay tribute to someone that they can't hear. I don't believe in that. But I will bring you fond memories of Nick and myself. Because I worked at the bakery at St. John's Place with Nick. And I've never seen a man learn to bake out of a book in my lifetime. You know, you learn to bake on the table. Nick learned to bake out of a book and became one of the best bakers in New York City. I worked with Nick as a delivery man and a part-time bookkeeper. And I made sure in his living years that I pitched with him several times. I did so on St. John's Place. I did so on Utica Avenue. I did so on Notion Avenue. I did so on Flatbush Avenue. I did so on Remsen Avenue. I did so several times. So may you rest in peace, Mr. Nick, and rise in glory. Thank you very much.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Arch Miller. In 1983, when I decided to start singing Calypso, I went to Nick. I said, Nick, I like a little sponsor. He said, no problem, Arch, I got you. And he always had me. And I just like to dedicate this song to Nick. And now the end is here. And so I face my final curtain. My friend, I say it clear. I state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full. I've traveled each and every highway. And more. Much more than this, I did it my way. Regrets, I had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do and saw it through. Without exception, I plan each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times I sure you knew when I bit off more than I could chew, but chew it all when there was doubt. I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all and I stood tall. And did it my way. Rest in peace, my brethren. Thank you.
I have a question. Is Boy Blue in the house? Boy Blue, please stand. Where are you? Somebody told me to look you up. Not here? Okay. You skipped town, huh? So any others? It's pouring outside, so you have nowhere to go. Any other comments? Okay. Just bow your head with me as I open up. Dear God, Father, creator of all nations, you gave us life so that we would know you as all powerful and all loving. Then you gave us your Son, Jesus, so that we would be guided down the right path while we live and breathe in the here and now and inherit a new life in heaven when this house of flesh and blood ceases to breathe. I pray you will be our eyes and watch us where we go, and help us to be wise in times when we don't know. Let this be our prayer when we lose our way. Lead us to a place, Father. Guide us with your grace to a place where we'll be safe. Amen. Brothers and sisters, friends of the Pitt family, all the families who are connected and friends who are connected, and then especially those who are mourning and have come to share memories. Yes, those who have come with grief in their souls, grief in their hearts, due to the loss of a good man, a good friend, a good partner, a good person. May this day cause you to look into your own life, your own direction, while you still live. May this day cause you to be a better man or woman, a better person, a better child, a better son, daughter, uncle, aunt. I ask you to consider a word that we all use so often. And I've heard that word here tonight in the dance that was so lovely done. That word is good. We use that word so often and so with so many different things. And I wonder if we really know what we are saying. It could be the most poorly used word in the English language. I don't know. But my thoughts are going towards that direction. Again, the word is good. You know, the word we say to people, good morning, but it's snowing 10 feet outside and it's raining or something, and it's so cold, you don't want to go out. But yet we say good morning. Or good day. When we got that phone call from IRS and you can't pay our bill, still somebody want to say good day to you. Good. It is used in so many different ways and different expressions. And you know, even Jesus had a problem with this word. If you look at Mark chapter 10, when you go home, read that passage, you'll see that at one point in his life, at one point in his travels, Jesus stopped to bless some little children. I don't know if he saw them playing on the side or if they were with their parents, but he stopped what he was doing and he went to bless them. And when he was finished and was on his way, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees and said to Jesus, good teacher. Yes, good teacher. What must I do to inherit eternal life? And guess what Jesus said to him? Why do you call me good? Why do you call me good? Now, I don't know what the expression on Jesus' face would have been on that point. Was he frowning? Why do you call me good? Was he saying it in a way that, listen, you don't know me? Why do you call me good? And then Jesus continued and said, there is none good. No one. No one is good except God. And that raises another question. Was Jesus saying that he was not good? He didn't include himself. He said, God is the only one that's good. The one to whom only the only person to whom that word would mean something. Why do you call me good? You know the commandments. He said to the man, you want to get to heaven? You want to live, have eternal life? Well, here are, you know the commandments. And you know what they say. Don't murder, don't commit adultery, don't steal, don't give false testimony, don't cheat or swindle, and honor your father and mother. I stop you a little bit. Everything else is don't. But when it comes to father and mother, do. Don't do these things. But when it comes to your father and mother, honor them. And then the young man said, teacher, all these I have kept since I was a boy. All these I have kept. Meaning he didn't do any of those things. He honored the Ten Commandments. He honored his mother and father since he was a boy. And still, Jesus said to him, one thing you are lacking. One thing you are lacking. Now, if you've heard and you know Jesus, you know that he can look inside your heart. He looks inside your head. He knows your spirit. So when this young man told Jesus that he did all of those things, and yet Jesus knew what was in him. Jesus knew the type of person he was. And Jesus told him, there's one thing that is so hard for some people. Go sell everything you have and give to the poor. You will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me. Go sell everything you have. Give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Now, reading that scripture, I don't think God means not for you to go out and sell your house and give to the people on the block. I don't think it means for you to go sell your new car and whatever, but it's not, I believe, Jesus was not talking about the things. He was talking about the attitude. The attitude. What's deep inside? What's behind what you do? What's behind what you get up in the morning? What's behind what you do on the job? Go home at night. What do you think of when you go home and say, well, my day is finished. What have I not done? What have I done? All these things I have done since I was a boy. And Jesus is saying this to the man. Come follow me. Now, in all of that brief verse, there's something that we still did not look at. Why is God the only good one and Jesus not good? Why did he not put himself in that sentence? Why do you call me good? Now we know Jesus is the Son of God. He was there at the beginning. He was there at creation with God, his Father. But one thing we look at as we come down to this point where he was born of the Virgin Mary, where he lived and grew down in that town in the area of Bethlehem, as he grew up to be a young man. The thing about Jesus that would fit here is that he was a human being. This was the Spirit of God within a man. Just like me, just like my brother here, just like any one of us. And what is it about us that is so true? We get upset. We hold grudges. We, you know, go off and shoot off when somebody does us wrong. We are not perfect. We have our bad ways and our good ways. We have our best friends and our best enemies. That's us. That's the human culture. That is somewhere we fight against it. We try to overcome them when things come up. But that's human. That's what God sent Jesus here to tell us about. That's who we are, but who we should not be. So it is possible and it is evident to say that within Jesus as the Son of God walking the hills and the valleys of the Bethlehem area in the Middle East, he had the elements of a human being within him. That's why he did not want to be called good. If you remember some of the stories about him when he went to the temple and saw how the Jews were, what they were doing in the temple, selling stuff, bringing things in and not doing what was supposed to be done on the temple. And what did Jesus do? He got so upset. He got so mad. He got so angry. That he got some whips and started whipping the people who were there selling things, because this was God's church, he said. This is my Father's house. How dare you do what you're doing? And you remember the story. He knocked over the tables with the monies on it. He kicked the people out of the area. All because they were defaming the house of God. Where did Jesus get this anguish? He was a man. So why do you call me good? Jesus looked at him. And the Bible says eventually that the man went off. He went on his own business because he knew he was a rich man. Couldn't give away anything. Couldn't sell. Couldn't help. Like I said about our brother tonight, how he through his business, he helped people to grow. Through his position, he got the message out to different individuals. This is how you can get established. This is how you can have a business. This is how you can be bigger than you are. We still have that question in our heart. Because regardless of what the man said, I can't do that, Jesus. I am rich. Yet today we still have that same issue. We know that we should not steal and give false testimony. We know that we should not lie and steal. Anyone here who knows in their hearts and their heads that, hey, I want to be in heaven. I want to go to heaven when I die. And so we know that we should do good things in this life. But how many of us sell that thing that we love so good, so the most, and give it to the poor? How many of us would stop on the street where there are people laying down on the ground, on the sidewalk, and say, listen, can I give you a dinner? Can I stop there at that restaurant and buy you something? How many of us want to be good people so that God will look at us and say, my good and faithful servant? The man's face fell, the Bible said, and he went away sad because he had great wealth. And then Jesus looked around at his disciples and he said, how hard it is for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. I think God is saying the same thing tonight. How hard it is for people who know what is right to do, for them to do right. How hard it is to give a part of who we are so that somebody else can rise up. How hard it is for us to take what we know, the knowledge that we have established, and teach it to some young person so that they will not be in trouble when they grow. How hard it is. But the disciples that were with him were amazed at his words. Jesus said again, children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. How hard it is. Now, depends on what you have heard and what you know. Sometimes it seems so easy to enter the kingdom of God. And some people want to make it easy. You know, all you got to do is go to church. All you got to do is become a Christian. And what does that mean? Well, go to church and pay some tithes and be there all the time, and you are a Christian. How hard it is to do what God says, what Jesus said to the man. There's something you have to give, something not of the stuff, but of you. You have to give. And I think tonight is what we are celebrating. That our brother gave of himself. He gave of his knowledge. He gave of his time. He didn't say, well, I'm getting too rich to, and I don't want anybody to come and take my money or give it to somebody. He, from what I've heard, he gave. The disciples were even more amazed and said to each other, who can be saved? And that's what I'm asking you tonight. Who can be saved? As far as Jesus is concerned, as far as God is concerned, anybody can be saved. Jesus said to them, "With man this is impossible, but with God all things are possible." Brothers and sisters, tonight I want to tell you, you're going to hear from people who is telling you that something you have your heart set on is impossible. Something you want to do to help somebody else is impossible. But with God, I'm saying it again, all things are possible. May those who are struggling at the modern day pools, may they receive their healing, I pray. As your followers bow and kneel in your presence, Lord, I pray you receive them, their favor. May those same words continue to draw us all nearer to you, Lord. Those same words. For it is our goal that when we have heard from you, each heart will be able to say, "The Lord has done this for me because I am highly favored." The Lord has done this for me. Not that I did it for myself. Not that I did it on my own. But because I gave, the Lord has done this for me. God has shown us favor and has thrown our seas into the sea of forgetfulness. Good, good. Let this be a good night. Let the rest of your life be a good life. So that when you come up, when you come to look at Jesus and ask yourself, "What is it this for me?" Jesus can say, "Welcome, my good and faithful servant." We will not be afraid, for no word from our God will ever fail. Our souls glorify him. Our spirits rejoice in him. We call him blessed. He calls us sons and daughters. We call you blessed, Lord and Savior, for it is your love that we live and have our being. It is by your mercy that has lifted up our humbleness, our humble selves. It is your compassion that has filled us so that we can go out and say, "El Shaddai, Lord God Almighty, your name is Almighty, Adonai, Lord and Master, Jehovah Nissi." Your banner is Jehovah Rapha, our healer, Jehovah Shammah. You will never leave us or fail us. And your name is Jehovah Ra, our shepherd. So, Father, my prayer tonight is that you lead us down the right path. Restore us with our cups running over. Calm us when the storms of life try to overtake us, and be our light when we go through those dark times. We rejoice as we lift up your name, the name of the Father, the Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. God bless all of you. May He be number one in your hearts and number one in your lives, number one in your homes, in Jesus' name. Now you can clap. Praise God. Praise God. We have now the prayer of comfort by Edith. Don't hit me if I get that name wrong. Quiroga. No. Oh, okay. This is Ayanna Watts, Ayanna Watts Jones, and she's going to bring some music to you.
Praise the Lord. Good evening, everyone. We're going to do a congregational hymn. It's going to be hymn 100, The Lord's My Shepherd. The word should be on the screen.
Answer.
Greetings again in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. This evening, I'm really moved because this is a service of celebration of Ivan's life, all that he's done and the impact he's made with others around him. And I want to just say thank you for everyone who's come out to show support and offer sympathy to the family. And as the minister said, we have to be good in this life. We don't wait till the last minute. We never know when our time is going to come, so we've got to be prepared. Because after this life, we want to be in heaven with the Lord for eternity. Amen? And let us now go to God in prayer. Almighty and most eternal Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus Christ, O Lord. Lord, I lift up everyone in this place, Lord. We thank you for Ivan's life and the impact he's had on family and friends and community, O God. We thank you and we praise your holy name. And Lord, we ask that you will reach out and comfort the family and friends and everyone who are, as we mourn his passing. O God, we thank you for his life, but there's comfort in you, O God. We ask for your grace and your mercy for everyone, and if let them know that if they reach out to you in faith, you're faithful and just, and you will strengthen them and comfort them, because you are the comforter. Lord, We ask that everyone in this place, if they're going through anything, if they've lost loved ones or going through sickness or anything, Lord, right at this moment I ask that you will reach out and do a miracle for them and just heal them, strengthen them, and comfort them. You know the needs of everyone in this house, oh God. I ask that you will give them your grace and your mercy at this time. Lord, I pray for Carol, Eureka, the close family and friends everywhere. Dear Lord, we ask that you will strengthen them, Lord, in a mighty way, mighty way. When they're going down, oh God, let them look up and say, Lord, I know you're here. Hold me. As we read and we believe, if we're in the valley, we don't give up because you will take us to the mountaintop. And God, we thank you for that. But we have to come to you in faith. In faith we ask, and Jesus said, if we ask in faith, ask anything of the Father, he will grant it to us. And we, as we know, you will never leave us nor forsake us if we come and live righteous lives pleasing to you as we go forward. We may not get the answers in our time, Lord, but we have to go forward in faith. And we thank you for that revelation to us. Jesus Christ came. He died for us to save us from our sins. And if we come to you, you will turn no one away. Because our hope is to be with you in eternity. And we thank you for your blessings. We thank you for your comfort. We thank you for Ivan's life. And we thank you for everyone in this place. I ask your blessing on each and every one in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Amen. And before I go, I just wanted to say, Ivan was the oldest of my mother's 9 children, and God has blessed him with a long life, and we thank God for that also. And now there are 5 of us left, and guess what? I'm the oldest one now. So the others have to obey everything I tell them. Well, I was always bossy anyway. But Perlene couldn't be here, but I know she's watching and I know she's praying for us. So we thank you all again and may God bless you all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's all stand. With Ivan Nichols, we honor your life and are blessed to have heard your laughter, seen your smile, and felt your reassuring hand in ours. Our lives are richer for having known you and having shared in the love you gave us and the love we felt for you. You are no longer bound by this world, but a part of it, no longer tied to one place or one time, but free. And so we commit you back to what you have been made, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. At the blowing of the wind and in the chill of winter, at the opening of the buds and in the rebirth of spring, we will remember you according to the promise of our Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen.
You may sit. Let the church say amen. On behalf of the Nichols family, we would like to thank Reverend Jones and his clergy for their ministry to us today. We'd like to thank the organist for his music from heaven. We'd also like to thank the song team. And to the many friends and family who came to show their love and support, the family would love to thank you. And to the family, on behalf of Stuart Furnell Services, thank you. Carolyn, thank you for giving me Dad to do the final care for him. I really appreciate it. And I hope that me and my team, we have made such a painful time a little bit easier to bear. Thank you, thank you. So, just a few things before the final viewing. After the final viewing, the family would like that you join them in fellowship at the Banashi Lounge. It's at the back of the program. That is at 1570 Ralph Avenue, Brooklyn, New York. Again, please join the family at the repast. So, we're going to have a final viewing now. Please listen very carefully. When you have viewed, you're going to exit the church and you're going to go downstairs and just congregate all family and friends, and we're going to have a dove release. I want it to be very organized. So again, when you exit out the door, you have to go down the steps and gather to the front. The family will stay on top to release the doves. Please do that in a very organized manner because we have to get to the repast hall. And I also have to take Mr. Nichols back to the front of home. So again, when you come to view, you go out of the church. Please remain seated until you're directed. And please greet the family at the repast. We have to do this very timely. Thank you. Okay. And we will have the final viewing serenaded by Sabrina. Okay, so we're going to start with those upstairs, and then when everyone has viewed upstairs, then we will start downstairs. Please remain seated until you're directed by the staff.
Why should I feel discouraged? And why should the shadows come? Why shouldn't my heart feel lonely?
Hey!
Remember to exit the chapel. Remember to exit the chapel and go outside downstairs.
You. You have. She's going downstairs. I'm gonna see. She's downstairs.
Marvel.
She's downstairs.
I think she went down. She went down.
Carol? Okay, they're coming
this way. ideally the part of Brother Ivan. Second, I'd like to thank Alva for allowing me to perform this service for you guys. Since the beginning of time, God has used the dove as a symbol of hope, faith, peace, love, and the Spirit. But not just any Spirit, the Holy Spirit. The part of us that never truly dies. So today, from the Sunshade Basket, we have one single dove symbolizing Ivan's ascent into the heavens. And in this other basket, we have six other doves representing angels escorting him into the heavens. Also representing seven, God's number of completion. So what I'm going to ask each and every one of you to do today is to please send your love upon the wings of Ivan's beautiful white dove. Because Psalm 55:6 tells us, oh, that I had the wings of a dove, and I would fly away from being wrecked.
Ivan is going.